Welcome back to OMFS lecture series. Continuing with condylar fractures, today we shall look into the clinical features, investigations and management of fractures of mandibular condyle. Let's see the clinical features associated with unilateral condyle fracture. There is often swelling and tenderness over the TMJ area of the affected side. There is hemorrhage from ear on the same side, which results from laceration of the anterior wall of external auditory meatus. Here it is important to distinguish bleeding originating in the external auditory canal from the middle ear hemorrhage. In middle ear hemorrhage, it indicates a fracture of the petrous temporal bone, and this may be accompanied by cerebrospinal otorrhea, that means escape of cerebrospinal fluid through the ear. It is known as cerebrospinal otorrhea. You will also find ecchymosis of the skin just below the mastoid process on the same side. This particular physical sign also occurs with fractures of the base of the skull, and it is known as Battle's sign. If the condylar head is dislocated medially and after all the edema has subsided due to passage of time, a characteristic hollow over the region of the condylar head is observed. So this is characteristic of unilateral condylar fracture. During opening, the mandible deviates towards the side of the fracture. That means it deviates towards the affected side. There is unilateral posterior crossbite. Displacement of the condyle from the fossa, or if the fractured condylar neck is overriding, then it causes shortening of the ramus on the same side and produces gagging of occlusion on the same side molars. There is also limited or painful protrusion or excursion. Excursion means while the mandible is being deviated to the opposite side, it is painful. In bilateral condylar fractures, all the signs and symptoms present in unilateral fractures may be present on both the sides. And overall, the mandibular movement is more restricted than in unilateral fractures. If there is a displacement of the condyles from the glenoid fossa or overriding of the fractured bone ends, then an anterior open bite is present. Pain and limitation of opening and restricted protrusion is present in case of bilateral fractures also. Bilateral condylar fractures are frequently associated with fracture of the symphysis and parasymphysis. Also, the appearance of an elongated face may be a result of bilateral subcondylar fracture. Here is a diagrammatic representation of the characteristic disturbances of occlusion after condylar injury. As you can see in the first diagram, this is a post-traumatic effusion or hemarthrosis. Hemarthrosis means collection of blood within the joint space. So this hemarthrosis may distract the joint surfaces, causing a posterior open bite on the affected side or the same side, with the deviation of the mandibular midline towards the opposite side. So this is characteristic of a contusional injury, or where there is bleeding within the joint space without any definite fracture. The second diagram is that of a unilateral fracture with significant dislocation or displacement. This may result in contraction of the fragments under the action of pterygomacetric sling with ipsilateral premature posterior contact. Ipsilateral means on the same side. So when there is action of pterygomacetric sling, it produces a premature posterior contact on the same side and the deviation of mandibular midline to the affected side. So there is premature contact and shift of midline towards the same side. The third diagram is that of bilateral fracture dislocation. Here the fractured condyles are dislocated medially. In this case, medially. This will produce a premature posterior contact on both the sides with no deviation. Here there is no shift in midline, but there is premature contact on both the sides with anterior open bite. This is characteristic of bilateral condylar fractures with dislocation. The fourth figure shows bilateral dislocation without fracture. Here the condyles are not fractured, but it is dislocated completely. It means the condylar heads are out of glenoid fossa. This is likely to produce an appearance of long face or prognathism. The patient is unable to occlude the posterior teeth. So there is almost complete inability to occlude any teeth, and there is appearance of prognathism or pseudoprognathism. So these are the characteristic disturbances of occlusion after condylar injury. Moving on to the investigations associated with condylar injuries. Recent advances in the field of imaging technology have enabled accurate diagnosis and localization of condylar injuries. So you may use conventional radiographic techniques like orthopantomogram, reverse Townes view or a transcranial view of TMJ to visualize the injured condyle. You may also use computed tomography and MRI or arthrography. MRI or magnetic resonance imaging is usually performed to study the soft tissues associated with the temporomandibular joint, and arthrography is mainly used to study the joint space. So these are the investigations associated with condylar injuries. The proper management of the fractured mandibular condyle is one of the most controversial topics in maxillofacial trauma. The commonly accepted goal of treatment is the re-establishment of the preoperative function of the masticatory system. That means it is important to restore the masticatory function as it was before the injury, and this involves re-establishment of the pre-op relationship of the fracture segments, the occlusion and maxillofacial symmetry. So even if you perform a perfect radiographic alignment of the fracture segments, it is not adequate if you are unable to achieve a fully functioning and pain-free joint. These are the general principles associated with management of condylar fracture. Whichever technique you follow, whether you do it conservatively or surgically, these are the principal goals you need to achieve. Now the treatment is divided into two schools: conservative or non-surgical and surgical approaches. Moving on to the conservative management of condylar fractures. Conservative approaches have been practiced by a majority of surgeons, and this technique is utilized for all kind of mandibular condyle fractures except those fractures which are an absolute indication for open reduction. Primary goal of conservative and functional treatment is to facilitate active jaw movement as early as possible and also to restore normal occlusion and neuromuscular pathways. The conservative management of condylar fractures can be as simple as observation and soft diet, or it may include variable periods of immobilization followed by intense physiotherapy. But still, close supervision is mandatory, and at the sign of any occlusal instability, deviation with opening or increasing pain, both clinical and radiographic revaluation should be performed. Any of these findings like occlusal instability or pain may indicate the conversion of treatment from conservative to surgical. Immobilization. Immobilization is one of the major components of conservative management of condylar fractures. The period of immobilization is controversial and must be long enough to allow initial union of the fracture segments, but short enough to prevent the complications. What are the complications associated with long duration of immobilization? They include muscular atrophy, joint hypomobility, and ankylosis. Currently, the period of immobilization ranges from 7 to 21 days, that is up to 3 weeks. This period may be increased or decreased based on concomitant factors such as the age of the patient, level of fracture, degree of displacement, or presence of additional fractures. So this is all about conservative management of condylar fractures. The second approach to manage a fractured condyle is surgical or open reduction. Zide and Kent have proposed a set of both absolute and relative indications for open reduction of the fractured mandibular condyle. The absolute indications include displacement of the condyle into the middle cranial fossa, impossibility of obtaining adequate occlusion by closed techniques or conservative techniques, lateral extracapsular dislocation of the condyle, any foreign bodies within the TMJ capsule, mechanical obstruction that impedes the function of the TMJ, and also open injuries like penetration, laceration, or avulsion to the TMJ. All these conditions require immediate treatment and is an absolute indication. The relative indications include bilateral condylar fractures in an edentulous patient where you cannot fabricate a splint because of severe ridge atrophy, unilateral or bilateral fractures where splinting is again not recommended because of any concomitant medical conditions or when physiotherapy is not possible, bilateral fractures associated with comminuted mid-facial fractures, and also bilateral fractures associated with other orthognathic problems. So these are the absolute and relative indications mentioned for opening a mandibular condyle. But still, you need to carefully evaluate the patient on an individual basis and then decide upon the treatment plan. Several surgical approaches to the condyle, and the location of the fracture and the degree of displacement decides the selection of approach to access the joint. Subcondylar fractures may be easily accessed via submandibular or retromandibular incisions, but the danger of these techniques is the possible damage to the marginal mandibular nerve. If the fracture is in the intracapsular or high on the condylar neck, then a pre-auricular or end-oral approach is used. It offers better access, more visibility, and ease of manipulation. Some surgeons use intraoral approach to reach the condyle. This approach has the advantage of visualizing the fracture reduction as well as the occlusion simultaneously. But the disadvantage of intraoral technique is that there is limited access, and also it is difficult to place certain fixation devices. Rightidectomy again provides a good access, and it is considerably aesthetic also because the scar is placed behind the ear fold. Hemicoronal approach is used when the condylar fracture is associated with concomitant midface fractures or frontal bone fractures. In such cases, hemicoronal approach can be used, which gives good access to the condyle. The vital structure at highest risk of damage during a pre-auricular approach to the condyle is the facial nerve. This diagram shows the relationship of facial nerve and its branches to the condyle and auditory canal. Here is the bifurcation of the main trunk of facial nerve. It is at this point that the facial nerve divides into its five peripheral branches. So this bifurcation is approximately 1.5 to 2.8 cm away from the lowest concavity of external auditory canal. This is the external auditory canal and the bifurcation is 1.5 to 2.8 cm away from this position, this point. Bifurcation is again 2.4 to 3.5 cm away from the post-glenoid tubercle. This is the posterior most tubercle at the glenoid fossa and the bifurcation is approximately 2.4 to 3.5 cm away. Here is the temporal branch of facial nerve, which is again 2 cm away from the most anterior concavity of the canal. This is the anterior concavity of the external auditory canal and the temporal nerve or the temporal branch is 0.8 to 3.5 cm away from the anterior most concavity. So it is important to keep these measurements in mind to avoid any damage to the nerve while placing an incision or proceeding with dissection. Here is a brief explanation of the pre-auricular approach. First, the skin in front of the tragus of the ear is infiltrated with local anesthetic solution to ensure hemostasis. Then the incision is outlined at the junction of the facial skin and the helix of the ear. The incision is usually 3 to 4 cm in length and has two limbs, an upper curved limb and an inferior vertical limb anterior to the tragus. Incision is made through the skin and subcutaneous tissues towards the depth of temporalis fascia. It is here that you encounter the superficial temporal vessels and it is retracted anteriorly. This is exposure of the temporalis fascia. At this point, you can palpate the zygomatic arch and the lateral pole of mandibular condyle. Here is the arch and here is the condyle. So at this point, you can palpate it using finger. Then you make an oblique incision on the surface of temporalis fascia. You place an oblique incision which is parallel to the temporal branch of facial nerve. The incision should be parallel so that it doesn't cut or it doesn't resect the nerve. It doesn't resect the temporal branch. So you place an oblique incision parallel to the temporal branch through the superficial layer of temporalis fascia. And this is all done above the arch. As you can see in the diagram, this incision and the dissection following incision is all performed above the level of zygomatic arch. You then insert a periosteal elevator beneath the superficial layer of temporalis fascia and the temporalis muscle and strip off the periosteum from the lateral aspect of the arch. You insert an elevator through this incision to reach the zygomatic arch and elevate the periosteum of the arch. The dissection is then carried out inferiorly to expose the capsule of the joint. As you can see in the diagram, as the dissection proceeds inferiorly, the capsule of the joint is visible, which is then incised and the fracture is exposed. So this is in general the principle and the procedure of pre-auricular approach to condyle. There are different modifications of pre-auricular incision. Pre-auricular incision is basically placing an incision within the skin crease in front of the tragus. As you can see in this diagram here, the dotted lines represent a classic pre-auricular incision. Several authors have given modifications to this incision by extending or altering it. For example, Alkaith and Bramley modification is the extension of pre-auricular incision anteriorly and superiorly. Few other modifications are inverted hockey stick incision by Blair, vertical angulated incision by Thoma, and Dinkman incision. Here is the Popovich incision, in which the preauricular incision is modified into a question mark shape. You have post-auricular incision. As you can see in the diagram here, the dotted violet lines represent post-auricular incision. This is placed behind the ear within the skin crease. You also have end-oral incision. This incision is carried through the skin over the tragal cartilage. It is not placed right in front of the tragus, but it is placed within the cartilage of the tragus. In this kind of incision, most of the vital structures are in the superficial plane, and it gives good access to both the joint and the coronoid process. This is another approach to the condyle, which is called the rightidectomy or facelift approach. This is an incision that provides the same exposure as the retromandibular and preauricular approach. Basically, it is a combination of both the retromandibular and preauricular approach. The advantage of this incision is that it is placed in a more cosmetically acceptable location. So in this figure, you can see all the incisions and all the approaches used to reach the condyle, that is preauricular incision, the end oral incision, inverted hockey stick incision, post auricular incision, and retromandibular incision. Here is the hemicoronal or bicoronal incision, which is used to gain access to the condyle when it is associated with midface or frontal bone fractures. Here the incision is placed in this manner, and the dissection is carried out through all the layers of scalp. After gaining a surgical access to the condyle, the fractured fragments are reduced in anatomical position and fixed using any of these methods. Transosseous wiring. This is used for subcondylar fractures. Here the condyle is approached through submandibular incision and holes are drilled in the fragmented segments. A wire is passed across the segments. It is twisted and tightened. In case of a high condyle fracture, this is a high condyle fracture where a preauricular incision will be better. Here the fragments are drilled obliquely from the lateral aspect of the fracture. That is, you know, a mandible has both the lateral and medial aspect. So while performing any procedure on the condylar head, you take access from the external or the lateral aspect of the mandible. So you drill a hole obliquely here so that you don't injure maxillary artery or other blood vessels in the vicinity. Again, transosseous wiring is performed and the fragments secured in place. The next technique is the Kishner wire or K-wire technique, in which a vertical passage is first drilled across the two fracture fragments and a K-wire is passed in through it. The wire is then secured using transosseous wires. The third technique is the intramedullary screw, which is placed through submandibular incision. It is a rather inaccurate technique and not used commonly these days. In bone pin technique, two pins are inserted on either side of the fracture site and connected by a condylar head and universal joint. This technique is also no longer in use, and if at all practiced, is very rare. Bone plating is the most popularly used fixation technique. Bone plates provide both stability and rigidity. It also has added advantage of easy application. This is an example of subcondylar fracture, which is stabilized using a mini plate. But whereas in case of multiple fracture, it is difficult to perform this procedure within the surgical field. Therefore, in such cases, the ramus is osteotomized in this way. The ramus is osteotomized and the fractured fragments are plated outside the surgical field. That is, the fragments are treated like autogenous bone grafts. It is treated totally outside. It is then plated to the main segment again using bone plates. So after fixation, the drains are placed, the wound is closed and pressure dressing is applied. The post-operative management includes analgesics, anti-inflammatory, soft diet and intense physiotherapy. Moving on to the complications associated with condylar fractures. There are early and late complications. Complications that occur concurrent or with the treatment of condylar fractures include the following: fractures of tympanic plate, fracture of the glenoid fossa with or without displacement of the condylar segment into the middle cranial fossa, damage to the cranial nerves 5 and 7, that is the trigeminal and the facial nerves, and vascular injuries. These are the early complications of condylar fractures. Late complications include malocclusion, growth disturbances, temporomandibular joint dysfunction and ankylosis in children. So with this, we have completed the topic on condylar fractures as well as management of mandibular fractures. Thanks for watching.